Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Grind Time. We are back once again. It's episode 10. I got the rhymes on deck. It's two episodes in a row. Yo, today's episode, I'm going to contact my man Gerald from Ballers Bridge. Shout out to Gerald. As y'all can see right here, he's got some nice shirts on deck. Pink, black, white, orange. They're lovely. They're amazing. Cotton feels good. Shout out to him. I'm going to call him here in a second, get him on here. Today, I think we're going to talk about the three guys that just committed to the G League. I feel like those guys are kind of familiar. I know those three guys from somewhere. I just don't know where I know them from, I guess. Actually, I think they played for a league called the Grind Session. Is that it? Huh. That's why they're so familiar.
Yes, sir.
G Money.
What's good, brother? What's good?
Yo. Tell the people who this is, man. Who am I talking to right now?
Yes, sir. This is Gerald Cannon, CEO of Ballers Bridge.
CEO. I like that. I like that.
Yeah, we here.
Give me a little bio, man.
Originally from Atlanta, Georgia. I live out in San Francisco now. We moved Ballers Bridge out to the Bay Area, Silicon Valley, to tap into the network in tech. But again, from Atlanta, went to high school at Tucker High School, man. Hooped at Tucker. Shout out everybody in Tucker. Went on to play college ball at Morehouse College, HBCU. And then after that, I was able to play professionally overseas for 5 years. I played in Japan, which was probably my favorite spot a couple times.
Ooh, that boy, Hooper.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Big buckets. Norway, Romania, Mexico. And then after I hooped, I was able to work in the NBA for a bit before with the Cavaliers before starting Ballers Bridge. So that's kind of a high level breakdown of who I am and kind of how I got to today.
Y'all heard Mr. Cannon say, big bucket. He's really a big bucket. Like, he's like 7'8". He's a huge bucket, you know. Tell me how you got involved with the Grind Session, G Money.
Yeah, for sure, man. I think it all started the first time I saw the Grind Session. I think is the big thing. Again, I'm in San Francisco. I was connected with a guy. His name was Graham Betchart. If I butcher your name, bro, I'm sorry. But shout out to my guy Graham. But he told me about a player. He was like, bro, you got to check out this player. He's in Napa, named Josh Jackson. And I'm like, Napa? Like, who's hooping in Napa? You know, I'm thinking that's wine. That's, you know, that's just a chill spot. But he's like, bro, come with me to practice because I'm working with the team on some mental training. And come and check out practice. I'm like, cool, bet. So we ride up to Napa, man. It's just beautiful. I'm just like, that probably was my first time ever even going to Napa. And I'm just like, man, what is this? So we get to the gym and we're just standing on the sideline. He's introducing me to the coaches and the players are kind of doing their thing. And I don't even think they warmed up. And I seen bro throw a lob to Josh and bro just caught it like off a drop step, like just standing there and windmilled it. And I was like, woo. And it wasn't one of them. It wasn't one of them. You know, crazy. The tip. You know, the rim grazer, nah. You know, that fake half wind. No, bro, windmilled it. He windmilled it. And I was like, oh, that's different. So just seeing the practice was whole different. And then I'm like, well, I got to see a game. Like, who are these dudes even playing? Because I can't imagine them playing like regular high schools around, you know, around the city. They destroyed them. And then I got a chance. I remember one game I got to see. I think it was Prolific versus Balboa, when Balboa had DeAndre Ayton. And I was like, okay, this is different. This is different. And I just stuck as close to the Grind Session as I could ever since, just because I recognized kind of where things were going and that the landscape was changing and they were at the forefront of it. You guys were at the forefront of it.
I'm going to tell y'all something to all the viewers and everybody out there listening and watching. You know, we have a lot of, you know, media people and everything that try to get into all of our events and stuff. And, you know, it's not the easiest. But, you know, for somebody like Gerald, it's actually pretty easy because there's a connection between Gerald and Ballers Bridge and the Grind Session at this point to where he's shown us enough love and shown us enough loyalty and respect to where we can, you know, bring him in on everything that we do. And, you know, we just want to give a special shout out to you because, you know, we appreciate you and everything that you do for us.
Yeah, likewise, bro. You guys are like family to me, man. I talk to, I feel like just about everybody, if not everybody, try to touch base. And it's bigger than hoop. You know, I think the environment, you know, the hoop is one thing that is at a different level, but it's also the environment. You know, it could be good basketball, but if the environment sucks, then it's not going to go far. It's the environment that's created that family-like atmosphere, whether it be during the games or after the games when everybody's just chopping it up and eating and just chilling. It's different, man. It's something to see for sure.
Yeah, my last episode, me and Coach Kendall, he touched base with that, and we was talking about the atmosphere and the family atmosphere and how, you know, it's easy to become a family in this type of atmosphere. And, you know, it's not just, oh, you see these people every weekend and you don't just, you know, see them be like, what's up, you know, and just keep going about your day. You know, there's actually some acknowledgement there. You know, there's actually conversations and deeper intels. You know, it's not just, hey, hi, how you doing? You know, there's always conversations we can have that always don't have to do with basketball too, you know. And, you know, also with that, you know, Gerald was very hospitable with us. Me and one of my coworkers, Chris, one of my best friends, I got to work with us at the grind session too.
My bro.
Gerald got to, he let us come out a couple days early for the Napa event, and we got to enjoy the city time. He showed us around San Fran and got to go on a taco tour. And, you know, it was a pretty nice time. But, you know, shout out to you for showing us a good time, man, you know.
Yes, sir. We kicked it. I think that's the family environment, man. We're going to all these different cities. I don't know anybody. I've seen as many cities as I've seen with you guys. And it's just fun, man. It's just fun. You guys always open the doors for me when I come out to Kentucky and people laugh and make fun of me. Like, man, you might as well just get a spot out here because I'm there so much. And it's appreciated. So that definitely goes both ways, man.
Man, always love. Always love. Oh, for a little bit. For a couple minutes, let's discuss the championship, man. Let's discuss the championship for a couple minutes. And, you know, unfortunately, we had to cut it short a little bit. We were fortunate to get through all the games. We just had to cut it a couple days short. And tell me a little bit about how your expectations were going into the championship. Like, who were your top guys to look at, your top team that you were, you know, thinking they could have taken home?
Yeah, it's tough, man, because I felt like this year, I think it was anybody could have taken that spot. Anybody could have won the whole thing. I think Prolific was obviously a favorite just because of how stacked the squad was and they were loaded. But just having watched like the West Oaks team the entire year, I thought those guys were so tough. The Central Point team, I think, was probably one of the more impressive teams to me this season just because I really didn't know how good they were and how hard they played and how well they were coached. So that was another team that I thought could have made a really big run. And then obviously OSL, man, those guys, man, tough as nails, competitive in anything they do. They're not going to back down. And I really thought that they had a shot at winning it too. So I think what happened, how it ended, it was unfortunate because I would have liked to have seen those guys get a little bit more rest and really be prepared. Because at that level, the level of basketball that we're talking about, you're not able to just, you know, just run it back. You know, it's like these guys are leaving it all on the floor. They're not taking possessions off. So to try to squeeze in two games like that in a day with a couple of hours in between, and a virus looming in the air, you know, of what's going to happen and kind of what's really going on. A lot of kudos to those guys, man, for putting on the show. But Prolific deserved it, man. They had a really good team, a really good year, coached well. I thought that they put in the work all season. They didn't dodge any teams. They were playing hard teams throughout the season. So I think it was good that they won and they deserved it for that first championship. That was big time.
Oh, yeah, I agree with that. Special shout-out to Prolific as well. If y'all don't know, they have a Super Team TV show going on right now, Overtime. The first episode dropped last week. The second one dropped this morning. Y'all should probably go tune into that. You know, the guy right here, you know, with the orange shirt on the camera right now, this guy got to make a couple appearances on there. You know, Gerald got to make a couple appearances on there. One specifically being Championship Day. I can't wait to see that episode, though.
Yeah, I'm sure that's going to be crazy.
Oh, yeah. Gerald, tell me a little bit about, you know, the season as a whole this season. How was the experience, you know, getting to travel around? You know, we got to go back to your hometown this year in Atlanta. You know, we got to finally get a tournament there. I got to finally influence the commissioner to get us a tournament there, and we got one, and, you know, it was nothing but good times, good food, great food. But, you know, tell me a little bit about the experience this year on the ground session.
Yeah, this year was fun, man. I think, again, being able to spend the entire year with the grind session and just being able to hit all the different stops, I learned a lot, you know, just being able to see kind of, again, where things are headed, being able to see the new players that had come in and players that weren't really getting a lot of hype before the season started. And then to come in at the end of the year and see them, you know, just counting off, running off offers, committing to big time schools. One player I can think of just off the top was Jabari Walker. I remember going out to Arizona before the season started and watching that team and just thinking like, man, these guys are stacked. But seeing Jabari, and I really don't think at that time he was picking up a lot of attention, but you could see in his game that he had all the tools to be a high major player. And then to kind of see his growth throughout the season, I'm pretty sure he won Defensive Player of the Year.
Yes, he did.
And just, you know, I thought that's what the grind session to me is about. I think you have the big time players and you're preparing the big time players for that next level, whether it be the highest school in the country or it is preparing them to go pro. And we saw that with Melo and Terry Armstrong and seeing those guys take the leap and going to Australia, which I thought was huge and groundbreaking. And then you saw it this year with all the players now that are on the new G League select team going pro. You see that this prepares you to go pro if that's in the cards for you. But if it's not, you can go from a guy that is under the radar, rarely being talked about, to, you know, signing a big time commitment to a school like Colorado. That's bigger than I think you can really put words to when you talk about the opportunities that are available for the players. So I really enjoyed the season, man, through and through, just going to the different cities and kind of having that experience. Again, the only thing I can really relate it to is during the AAU season when you make the different stops on the circuit. It seems like that, you know, here. But again, it's kind of different because of the number of stops throughout the season, the games and the intensity, because you know the players, they know you, and you really can't hide. You can't hide. Either you show up or you get exposed pretty much.
Yeah, ain't no running. Man, yeah. We'll touch on that G League in a little bit. I want to touch base on what you just said. Like you said, Jabari Walker being a perfect example, and I can't have said that any better. With a kid in Jabari's position, it's not easy to get looked at when you're playing for a team like AZ Compass, and you're not, you know, one of the quote-unquote superstar guys who has the social media presence and the college notice presence. Like, you know, they have Frankie and Tata and Sada. You know, they take a lot of attention away from everybody else, you know. So in Jabari's position, I feel like, you know, if he would have been on a normal high school team with kids, like, you know, when Melo and them were in high school, if he would have been on a normal team like that, it would have been hard for him to get those big looks. But, you know, being at a prep school, when you got college coaches in and out all night long, it's hard to not get noticed, especially when you play as good as ball as him. And I'm not saying that, you know, Jabari's not good enough to where he wouldn't get looked at a normal high school. It's just harder when you're at a normal high school. It's a different process. It's a different situation. And it's not a platform like the one that we have. And, you know, Jabari has game to where we both, like you said it in an early, and they're in the beginning of the season, and a lot of people didn't want to believe it. You know, Jabari was one of the top players, and he was going to be one of our best defenders and one of our best rebounders, and he turned out to be one of our best defenders, one of our best rebounders, and one of those guys that, you know, we could come to be fortunate enough to be positive about watching night in and night out.
Absolutely. And I think, again, just to kind of talk about what we do and kind of how I feel like our value to the grind session is, I think, like you said, when you're in a traditional high school, what happens, unfortunately, depending on your area where you are, it's a good chance that you can get swallowed up and that you won't get that type of recognition if there isn't a college that's close to you in your area, or if there, you know, there's no one kind of speaking on your name or giving you that word of mouth. Or now with the new media and people coming in and capturing content, if no one is talking about you because you're not a five-star or a top 100 player, it's very possible that you can continue to fly below the radar, may not even have an offer at when it's all said and done. And I hate that about how the space is in basketball. And that's kind of one of the things that we set out to help change. And that's why I appreciate you guys bringing us in and letting us help, because I feel like a lot of the issues a lot of times derive around quality game film. And having film that's out there so people can see it and actually see your game and see your work when they're not able to just pull up to a game and just see you play. And that's one of the cool things about the grind session. And what we really want to do is to, obviously, we want to show the highlights of Dayshin and Jalen and Amari and those guys, because, man, those are classic clips. We're going to be watching those things for years to come, you know, as those guys continue to grow. But what about the other players? You know, what about the guys that no one even saw, you know, that was going to be the next player, the Paul George or the Kawhi Leonard or Damian Lillard? You can run off Steph Curry. You can go all day with players that no one was talking about, and now they're the best players in the league. And that's why I think it's important to have quality game film on every player, not just hoping that one of them breaks through and is an NBA superstar. But, you know, they have a chance to play collegiate basketball. They have a chance to go pro overseas or whatever have you. There's so many opportunities in basketball and in sports in general that I think we have to try to serve every player, especially if they're in the grind session. Because if you're in the grind session and there's, what, 20, around 23, 25 teams, give or take, you know, and I'm just guesstimating, you can play, you know, no matter what team you're on, no matter what number you are, how many minutes you get. If you're on that team with the coaches that are in the league and they brought you into that team, you can play. So then that means you need to have video, and that's what's going to help you. So that's the value that we look to add. And again, that's the foresight of the grind session, of being ahead of the game and realizing that that's important.
You know, just this season alone, this class of 2020, we had over 200 players who are going to college to play basketball.
And, that's amazing, bro.
You know, it speaks for itself. You know, the platform speaks for itself. The total of all time, you know, including this year's class, is over 1,700. You know, that's just over a span of 5 years, man. It's not like we've been doing this for a long time. And, you know, a lot of people hate, a lot of people doubt, a lot of people throw salt and all that, and it's like, for what? Like, you know, it's not like we're even out here trying to brag about it or anything like that. It's like we're just trying to give these kids a bigger platform and better situations than what they are already in, so that, you know, they can have the opportunities that some of the people that are actually inside of the grind session and helping these kids, some of these guys didn't have that opportunity. So it's like we're trying to help y'all now at this point, you know. And I just don't see how it could get any better as far as the message.